Ein bisschen Ruhe.
Okay.
Oh, hört man das? Hm? Sollte man nicht hören?
I don't know. Like, can you hear me? Is there any microphone? Hallo? Ja. So okay, so let's start. So welcome to Scientific Programming this semester. My name is Rüdiger and this is Chris.
Can you guys hear the microphone or not?
Yeah, can you guys understand me? Perfect. So yeah, we are really happy with that there's so much interest in this course. Even though it's not, I guess, all 160 people that signed up on SUTIP, which is good because they wouldn't fit all in the room. So today we're basically just going to give you an introduction into the topic, like what we are going to do throughout the semester and how we are going to do it, so you can decide whether this is the right course for you. So let's start with some organizational stuff. So we have a lecture each week on Monday at this specific time slot, and we also have a tutorial session on Wednesday, where the tutorial session like is more for if you have problems with the homework or so, or any questions, where we sit there in a room, it's like over there in E42, and you can come there if you have like technical questions, and you can directly ask us. If there isn't any need, we can maybe add an additional practice session. Like the room over there is quite small, so if there's a lot of, if there are many requests and many questions, we can maybe at a different time slot, but we'll just see how it evolves. As we are at the university here, there's of course no mandatory attendance for this course, but still we'll endeavor to make this really worthwhile for you to come here. But if you really don't want to, it's also fine if you just learn the contents on yourself and just do the homework. If you still can't make it during this time slot, the lectures will also hopefully be recorded, though this is sometimes a bit unreliable, so I would not necessarily rely on that, but yeah, we'll see if there are some recordings online in SUTIP anytime soon. So for grading and credits, it's going to work this way, that we have homework each week that you have to hand in individually. That doesn't mean that you can't work on it in groups and just hand in the same thing, but still everybody has to hand in something. And if you really want to learn programming, it also makes sense that you program something yourself, because otherwise it's just like hard to learn something. The homeworks are going to be corrected automatically, so by some scripts. So that means that basically when you get the homework, you can just run the correction scripts yourself and see whether everything works out correctly. So you can be like 100% sure that you basically pass the homework and then just hand this in. But that also means that you have to get everything correct in order to pass. So there's no like partial points that you can get, like either you have everything correct, which you can test yourself and then you pass this week, or not and then you fail this week. In total we have like 12 slots and 11 homework sheets. And we have some bonus exercises as well. And in total, you will have to pass 9 of those sheets to get the credits in the end. So that means that there are 2 homework sheets that you don't really have to do, or you can do some extra bonus sheets and then you have to do less in the end. And if you pass enough sheets, you will get 4 ETCS credits for the Profilbildner Wahlbereich. So that means that there's no specific module towards this course here counts, but you can use it like in this free credit area somehow. But anyway, we just assume that most of here, because you want to learn something, not because you are required to be here by some kind of regulation. So yeah, as we said, like the shine will not count towards any module. Yeah, so about us, as I said, my name is Rüdiger, I'm in the 4th semester Master of Cognitive Science, and it's my 10th overall semester. Like, I studied biology before, and I have like 3 years of experience with Python, and this is my email address. And for Chris, I think I'm just going to come over here.
I'm Chris. Hi. Yeah. You can read it. I'm the 3rd master here, my 10th Coxy overall. Around the same amount, I guess, of experience in Python, and my email is there.
Yeah. So, and in general, if you have any questions or suggestions, don't hesitate to write us an email. Or maybe even better, just write something in the forum. So if you have some question towards the homework, maybe it's a question that many people have. So if we answer it once there, then it will help everybody. If you have suggestions towards the contents of the lecture, if you have some specific wishes, you are welcome to write us. And if you find any errors in the homework, you will see that we do basically the whole homework thing via GitHub. and you can just file an issue there on GitHub on the respective homework repository. So the URL is here, and basically every specific homework will be a specific repository under this URL. So yeah, this is towards the organizational stuff. So maybe are there any questions regarding this basic organizational information? Yes. Yes, we'll upload those slides on StudIP. Like in the future, we'll probably not really have slides, but more Jupyter notebooks, which will be hosted on GitHub. So you can just download them from there, but this slide set will be uploaded on StudIP like after we finish here, more or less. Anything else? Yeah.
Should we just go one slide back? Just
yeah.
Last year we were supposed to pass like 50% of the exercises, or six of them, but this year is like 9.
Yeah, this year it's more so because we got some feedback from last year, and like the problem is if you only do like 50%, you're probably like do the first task and then you have the basic skills, but you're not really get towards really interesting scientific things to really like be able to use Python for your scientific workflow. And I mean, like, we'll also invest a lot of time to create these exercises and just make sense that everybody has also an incentive to do them in the end. And I guess that everybody will learn more if you really have to do them. But as I said, like, it's not going to be like the purpose of these exercises not to be super hard and really take a lot of time, but really just to engage you with the things we'll talk about here.
There are 2 ones this week already, by the way, so you have 2 out of 9 already today if you do it.
Yeah, so I think like passing the homework shouldn't really be a problem. It's just like that you really stay here throughout the course and not everybody drops out after half of the course, which kind of doesn't make sense. Okay. Yeah, so then I'm going to talk about why we even have a course like scientific programming. Like if we want to do science, like we don't want to be IT guys, why do we have something like scientific programming? So in order to answer those questions, we need to think a little bit, what does science actually mean? Of course, it's like not really the purpose here to give an exhaustive definition of what science is, but I have some points here that hopefully everybody can agree is like a crucial part of what science tries to achieve. So with science, we try to build and organize knowledge, and we want to test explanations about our world, right? We might observe some processes, we form some hypotheses about how they might work, then we design some experiments, change some parameters, and we test like whether our hypothesis could be true, and then we basically maybe in the end publish a paper and contribute towards this knowledge base, and then hopefully at some point we can build like more consistent theories that help us to understand our world. And this is basically what we want to do and how we want to do it. We want to do it systematically and objectively, right? We do not just want to find out the things that we want ourselves to be true, but that are true overall. We also want to do it transparently, so other scientists and also other people can verify and understand what we did, and we want to do it in a reproducible manner. So if we have an experiment that only works out when we do it one time, then it's probably not really a scientific finding that's worth to be published. So, and I basically landed this list from a talk by Katie Huff on best practices in scientific computing, and she basically claimed, and I would totally agree with it, that if you don't comply with these terms, so to say, it's not really science what you do. Like lately, you might have heard that there was something called like psychology crisis or a crisis in science. Things are not reproducible. But I would just say there's probably not something wrong with science, but just with the way that science was done. So, and what we believe is that programming basically helps us to fix these problems and also helps us to achieve all of those goals. So for building and organizing knowledge, for example, you can build databases of scientific results. So this, for example, has a long tradition in biology and chemistry, where you have lots of databases of different compounds and proteins and their properties, but also, for example, in cognitive science, I believe like Timo Schmidt also had a database of like some different results of drug science. So it's really helpful if you do not just have different results scattered throughout a lot of different papers and different journals, but maybe have some consistent source where you can find everything at once. Yeah, for testing explanations about our world, it's really helpful to be able to automate experiments. So you can definitely do this using programming languages, also like Python, what we will teach you later in this course. And definitely it increases our productivity, so to say, as scientists, right? We do not just want to spend time conducting experiments, but we would just spend more time thinking about the results of our experiments and maybe thinking about new experiments. Systematicity, I think, can also be achieved if you have something coded up. It reduces the risk of human errors than if you conduct the experiment yourself, or if you maybe even calculate something by hand in your analysis, which I hope no one does anymore these days, but you never know. For objectively, also you could say that algorithms are not really subject to human biases. Of course, algorithms are always created by humans and might inherit the biases of their creators. But in general, if you like have some general purpose algorithm like linear regression, where you try to fit a line through a cloud of points, the algorithm doesn't really care whether you want the line to go up or go down in the end. So I guess a lot of biases are alleviated by using programming here. And on the transparency side, we can really do a lot by using open source tools and also sharing our analyses afterwards. So by this, basically, we enable the whole scientific community to really look into our results, how we did the experiment, how we analyzed the data. Everybody can verify whether this was done correctly, and also errors can be detected more easily than if you just report in the end, I found some significant effect on this, and this is all that is said. And also, for making things reproducible, it's also helpful if you code up your analysis, and then basically everybody can execute the script on its own and basically see whether it still works. And the same basically goes for automating experiments. Like, this just reduces a lot of errors that are usually done in the process of conducting experiments. So just one word of warning. So in order for these points to really be valid, you kind of need to write clean code, right? If you say like, okay, I want to share an analysis and now everybody has insights, but if you just named all your variables from A to Z, no one will understand your analysis and it's not really helpful. So, and we will basically hint throughout the course at some points that you can keep in mind to really make your code more readable to other humans. You were convinced before that programming is helpful for science. I hope you are still convinced about this fact. And still, if you want to do scientific computing, you need to decide on some technology that you want to use. So the question is, why did we choose to use Python here? So Python was created in the 90s by Guido van Brossum, Dutch guy, and basically quickly evolved into an open source project that is developed by now the Python Software Foundation and by a big community of different contributors. It's kind of a high-level language, so you basically do not really have to care about the bits and bytes inside your computer memory. You can really more think about the objects in your domain. And it's so-called interpreted and dynamically typed, which just means that it's really easy to write, and you don't have to put type declarations everywhere, which also means that it's kind of fast to write Python code. And it has really a consistent and minimal syntax, so it's also really easy to read. And just to sum up this, it's easy to learn and write, which is, I guess, also due to the fact that it was originally created based on a language that was just designed to teach people programming, which was called ABC. But by now it's really has evolved into a major programming language that is not just helpful for educational purposes, but really can also be used in science in any kind of production environment. So probably the killer feature of Python is that it has really a great ecosystem and a great community. So there are lots of different tools basically for anything that you can think of. There's some kind of library or framework that you can use, and there are always people on the internet that will help you to use these tools. There is usually always great documentation that you can follow, a lot of tutorials online, and that is something that is really outstanding in the programming context. So of course there are other tools that are used for scientific programming. Our claim here is just that Python is generally better than all of those, at least for scientific programming. So I'll just give some reasons why it's better. So some of you might have heard or even used the R language, which is designed for like statistical analyses on data sets, but really just specific like for statistics. So the benefit of Python is that it's not just useful for statistics, but once you need to do something different, you can just still use Python. You don't have to use any other language. With R, it's kind of gets difficult. So our opinion is that it's not really necessary to have it. Like you can do everything you can do in R, you can also do in Python, but not the other way around. Then there's MATLAB, which was, I guess, kind of standard for a long time in both science and engineering. The problem with MATLAB is really that it's not an open source project, so no one really has the source code and everybody has to pay to use it. So basically for every license that you use just for plain MATLAB, you have to pay like already €1,000 or something.
2,000 for plain, plus even
okay.
2,000.
Okay, so it's 2,000 for the plain thing, and then there are like a lot of different toolboxes, so-called toolboxes, like different libraries for doing more domain-specific things, like if you want to do image analysis, and you pay 1,000 extra or so. And in the end, you just pay a lot of thousands of money in your lab, which you could also have invested into lab equipment or whatever. And also a problem is like if you create something and you have like there's a new version every half a year. So for example, you have MATLAB 2016A because at that time you bought all the licenses and you share your code. Someone else has 2017B, it still doesn't work again. So basically not really useful for sharing any kind of code. So really my recommendation, don't use it. Then there's C++, which is also used in some scientific context. It's, I guess, also a great language, but it has a totally different focus than Python. Like, it's really, you can operate really close to the hardware and really write really efficient code. Has tens, not thousands different keywords, probably not, but it gets in this direction. So it's really complex, not easy to write, not easy to learn. It takes years to basically figure this out, and you really have to be an expert to write somewhat usable code. So for most of the things, it's really not so nice. It takes much longer to get a usable thing in C++, and also there's no tradition of writing user-friendly documentation. So if you find any library, there might be libraries for everything, but no one knows how to use them except the creator. So this is also not the best, and like some of you, I guess, who at least the ones of you who did Info-A might be acquainted with Java. I think Java still has its place in like enterprise and industry, but for science, there are not really so many libraries, I believe, and it's also like very verbose and overly complex if you just want to do simple analysis, so Java is also not an option. So yeah, the only thing that is left is Python, which is good as well, and I'll just show you like basically our path through the scientific ecosystem that we are going to take through the semester. So of course at the beginning we'll just start with plain Python and teach you like how you can use the programming concept you might have learned in other languages in Python, and then also some more advanced concepts that are more specific to Python. And then basically we'll start with the like core layer, so to say, of the scientific ecosystem. So there are things like IPython and Jupyter, which are basically for creating an interactive environment for doing computing, so that you don't have to write a really long script until you see something. But for example, in Jupyter, you get like this kind of programming notebooks where you can basically match text with formulas and also code, and you can just write a bunch of lines and get the output of those lines directly in your notebook. And this is really helpful for creating analysis, so you can directly see the plots that came from your data. Then next, we're going to look at NumPy. So NumPy basically provides the core data structures for doing numerical computing in Python. So if you have like big arrays of huge numbers, you want to use NumPy because otherwise it won't be fast enough. So and basically NumPy provides this multi-dimensional array objects where you have like, so to say, cubes of data, and then you can do like fancy slicing operations. And this is basically all the scientific tools in Python built on this library, and we'll have a look at it more closely. Then, so to say, the next layer of extraction are tools that basically operate on NumPy arrays, but provide some more specific tools. So there's Matplotlib and SciPy. Matplotlib is really famous for being able to create like pixel perfect figures for your publication, so you can really have a fine grained control over how you create plots, and you can basically any plot that you can think of, at least in 2D, can be done in Matplotlib. And then SciPy is just like a loose collection of scientific tools that you might use at some point. So this is how Matplotlib plots look like. So next then, we'll spend some time for looking at pandas. So pandas provides this data frame object, which is really handy for handling tabular data. So basically, if you don't want to have like a multi-dimensional cube for your data, but just like a table that you might know like this, like from Excel, for example, like a spreadsheet, you can just have different rows, different columns, and then you can basically do some fancy data manipulation operations. So you have this relational view of data, and you can join different data sets and analyze different data sets based on different groups. And I guess right now there's no one who really does data analysis in Python without using pandas, so it's a really useful and also very good tool to have in your toolbox. And then, yeah, so to say, on the next layer we have things that are even more specific towards different use cases. So specifically we're going to look at visualization and statistics. So visualization is already provided by Matplotlib, but as I said, that is really fine-grained control over how you create your plots. If you already have your data set basically described in a data frame where you have all the columns labeled, and so you can easily create plots that gives you deeper insights into your data. So for example, you can create like a scatter plot matrix like this in just one command without, like in Matplotlib it would probably take a few more lines. So where you have like all your variables split up on the on the different axes and see how the different variables behave in correlation to each other. Or you can also create box plots like this and much more, and will show you basically how to visually analyze your data before you commit towards any more fine-grained statistical analysis. And then we'll look into stats models, which basically, as the name says, gives a framework for creating statistical models to analyze your data. So mostly linear and generalized linear models. So basically the idea is that instead of like doing much of the computation yourself, you just say, okay, I have some data here, again in the pandas data frame, and then I say, okay, I want to explain this variable, for example, lottery by literacy and some population, and then this is all you have to do, and then you get like a really big table with a lots of, you directly see like what are the coefficients, is it significant, you get a lot of statistics that have some meaning probably, and that we'll figure out when we really talk about this. But you basically get everything that that you need when you do statistical analysis in just one command. And then finally, we'll look into some more domain-specific libraries. So there are a lot of domain-specific libraries, like there's something for analyzing sun data, if you ever want to do research into suns. But there are also things for example, neuroimaging. And we'll specifically look into PsychoPy, which is a tool for creating psychological experiments in Python. For example, like eye tracking, and you can really see, say, like what different things you want to measure, which variables you want to create, like how your experiment is going to look, which stimuli are shown to the subject, and stuff like this. So, and with this, we'll hope that we'll give you a toolbox to basically use Python in your entire scientific workflow. So from creating your experiments and conducting your experiments with PsychoPy throughout really extracting your data and cleaning that up with NumPy and pandas, and then first in the beginning visualize and explore your data and see if you can find any trends, and then you can really start to create statistical models and say basically, is there any effect that is worth reporting in a paper? Yeah, so on the exact outline is going to look like this. So this is basically just what I just showed you. Intro is today, then we have two lessons basically on just plain Python, then NumPy, Matplotlib, this data frame stuff in pandas in probably three lectures if we need the time, because it's really so important, then one on visualization, one on statistical models, and then one on PsychoPy, and in the end probably just something on like what other tools exist and what could be helpful, so that you have an idea of what is there, and if you ever need something like this, you know where to go. But if there are other requests, we can also do something different probably. And just for comparison, so as you know, there's also a basic programming course in Python, so if some of you are still not sure which course to take, so this is the outline for the basic programming course. And so I can basically tell you, so they also do NumPy, Matplotlib, what we do here in week 4, they do in week 12, so basically this whole stuff will be in the first 3 weeks. So there's basically no problem also with taking both courses, I believe, if you really want to, but you can decide yourself which better suits you, and of course we are very happy to keep all of you here. That much for basically the introductory part on this, and now we have some questions towards you, because we would also like to get to know you and basically know what your background is, and we prepared some clicker questions on StudIP. So you should all either scan this QR code or just go to this link, which might be even easier, and there we have some questions that we will also show you here, I believe.
Do we?
Once Chris will open up the question.
There should be something now.
Jo, kannst du das die Gerichte die vielleicht QR-Code rüberziehen? Das wäre, das werde ich jetzt zeigen.
Ja.
Okay, willst, soll ich das machen oder willst du das machen?
Okay.
Yeah.
You mean the QR-Code?
Yes.
Are we supposed to commit the solutions via GitHub?
Yeah, we will explain. The question was, are we supposed to commit the solution via GitHub? The answer is yes, and we will the next 45 minutes explain how that works after the clicker questions. Oh, yeah. I think I'll close this one. There are like 10. Okay. Do those percentages make sense? Yeah, they would. Okay. So most of you had info R. Just go, oh, it's still changing. Okay, so we just want to have some, we just want to know some things we can assume you having done. There's another one now in Clicker. Like I said, there are like 10, just answer one after the other. That one's public now, is it?
I mean, should be safe, still the same link, right?
It is the same link, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we're 40. Oh, you guys are so fast. Pardon? Oh.
Yes.
Right.
Ich bin da nicht drauf gekommen. Die Art der Abstimmung funktioniert ja so gar nicht, das stimmt. Oh shit, ja, das ist eigentlich voll sinnvoll, gerade auch bei dem UVA, wenn du halt nicht mal ein UVA gemacht hast. Das macht sehr keinen Sinn.
Naja, aber das ist ja schon.
Dem ganz ehrlich. I think I shut this down to the next one. Anybody? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So, you may be wondering why there are some which we didn't talk about so far. We weren't sure on what exactly we are going to have in this lecture. So, I want to see what you guys actually want to use Python for. What the fuck? What is it doing? Hello, I skipped a few. Because this here is now, what do you want to use Python for? Next one should be up. So we want to have an overview of what you guys are actually looking for in this class, and we thought that questions may somehow get it. Oh yeah, sorry for the ones who don't study cognitive science. Just noticed. I think you can then to skip this question, obviously. Maybe you want to use linguistics as data analysis, or maybe you want to use linguistics as doing stuff. So I see that as two different things, and it will change anyway. So. Oh yeah. More than 80, I'm going to shut this down too. Okay. So this one is about basically the first few lectures where it's about basic Python. If you've heard those expressions, so those are Python concepts. If you've heard those expressions and know and have used it like once, answer yes, otherwise answer no. Again, none of these options would have been useful. Repository neu.
Du musst einfach in uns halt haben. Aber in den Bayern?
Dann habe ich die aus Versehen irgendwann in mein globales Python installiert. Okay. Is there anybody who would have answered none of the above? That's not an option. You can't select one or none of the above, right? I think it doesn't matter too much then. Nobody says anything here. Wie lange redest du gerade?
Mhm. Ich habe auch gerade schon.
Ja, egal. Komm schon, reicht ja.
Ich kann es sonst auch. Wir machen einfach Pyfix-Style-Pytest und schreiben das gleich in die Arbeit.
Ich habe ja Pyfix, bei mir klappt das ja.
Ja, du kannst ja trotzdem machen.
Aber es muss in die Gefahr.
Wir machen Coding bleiben.
Nee, ich nicht. Schreiben. Ich mach das kurz.
Ich meine, da wissen die Leute jedenfalls, was sie tun.
Ja, okay, das stimmt vielleicht. Test. Tatsache, I didn't. Aber ja klar, ich hab's ja in meinem globalen. Das ist ja auch kein Ding. Guys, next question. Zum Beispiel, das reicht nicht für Energy Kill machen. Okay, this is the last one. All right, that would be it for the clicker questions. Thank you. We want to use this just as a rough basis on where to direct the class to. If there would be many linguists here, for example, we would try to include something like NLTK. They're not, so this probably won't happen. But yeah, thank you.
Okay, so back to the presentation. Yeah, so now we're basically going to show you how you can set up your system for the course and how you can basically hand in the homework. I'm just going to say a few quick words on virtual env, and then Chris is introducing Git, and also give a live demo about really like how you can sign up for the homework, how you can do them, and how you basically hand them in. So virtual environments are something that many people using Python are often not familiar with, even though it's kind of important. So usually, like, if you want to use Python, you have to install it. So there are cases like on Linux, and I think even on Mac, Python is pre-installed, but that is because it's used by the operating system in some way. And what you basically shouldn't do is misuse this operating system or system Python for your own scientific purposes. So because that can lead to you install some strange library, you basically destroy your Python environment, and then your operating system doesn't work anymore, which is kind of inconvenient. So on Windows, you have to install Python anyway, so then it makes sense to use something like a virtual env anyway. So a virtual environment is basically something that encapsulates the whole Python installation, like including the plain Python interpreter and all the packages that you need in your project. So in general, it makes sense to have basically one environment for each project that you are working on. And there are different tools to create these environments, and the easiest one usually is Conda, because it works on all operating systems. And yeah, there's a link to a cheat sheet, but we also have instructions in the homework where to install this from, and then you will basically just create a new environment like for working on all the homeworks, and then you activate your environment when working on your homeworks, and afterwards you just deactivate it again and do whatever you do. And yeah, and this will basically allows you also to have different versions of Python with different set of packages with different versions side by side without anything getting in the way of each other. Okay, so that's for that, and now Chris will start with Git.
All right, actually, as we saw from the surveys, most of you did use apparently Git already. That's good. For everybody else, I'm going to give a relatively quick intro to Git. So what is Git? Git is a version control system. With version control systems, well, you can escape your mess of having to versionize your programs yourself. So if you have a program, you're currently working on it, and you have this one working version of the project, and you want to add some functionality which you think may break the entire project, what you would do if you wouldn't use a version control system is you would maybe like copy all the files into an extra folder and then do the new stuff and then lose your backup copy and then have a problem. With Git, it's much easier because it allows you to track changes to files over time and even have multiple versions parallel in an easy and obvious way. So commonly, version control systems are used for programming projects, but they can be used for basically any project. I personally, for example, also use them for to-dos because it makes sense because you have the entire history of that. So it's a really useful thing to know generally. Like I said, why would we use version control? Because otherwise you have version hell. So this is what it would look like before you use Git. You have this final, and then a final, and then final, some features added, and then you back up some files, and some files you don't. And this is just really messy. And with version control systems, it's just not messy at all. You have one version of your project, and your version control system tells you how to get the old version. So what it does, it is tracks and logs changes in your files with author, timestamp, and description. So timestamp obviously automatically. Author is useful if you collaborate with many different people on the same projects that you know who did what. And the description you have to provide yourself, which makes total sense because you can tell what you did in the earlier version and why you're committing now. So what you can do with the version control system is you can restore old versions safely without destroying the new ones. You can have even multiple versions running in parallel. If you, for example, have a big project where there's a development branch and a main branch which must stay stable, you can add new unstable features to the development branch by keeping the master main branch without the changes and without breaking. And you can analyze the code, you can check differences you made. If some error occurs, you can just look at the difference from the previous version of the files to the new version of the files to see what you changed and what may have broken it. Okay, so the most important thing of Git, of version control systems, is the commit. So a commit is a snapshot of the whole project at a certain time. So you're coding, you're thinking, okay, this is a good version, everything works, I added a few features, and before I add new features, I commit. So what a commit does then, it saves its predecessor, the old version of the code, saves changes in the files, so the delta from the predecessor, from the previous commit. So in contrast to copying all the files all the time, Git also saves a lot of storage, because if you only change like two files in a project consisting of 200 files, it only says, yeah, it's the old ones, but this changed in those two files. And as I said, it saves author time and commit message. A commit in Git is identified here by a hash. So here we just call the hash C1, C2, and so on. And really, it's a kind of long string. Okay, so imagine this is our project. Make a first commit when there's an empty directory. And then we add some files, for example, markdown file readme and two code files. We make a new commit, and then we change those files. They're still the same files, but now we named the folder code into a folder source. And then we make a new commit from that. And now we have those three commits, which base one on the other. Okay, so after the commit, we have the repository. The repository, Git repository, is basically the database of all of the entire timeline of your project. So in the version database, you have the history of all commits. This history of all commits is saved in a hidden folder in the file system, in the folder of your project called .git. And as soon as you commit your staged files, I'm going to explain what stage means in a second, from your working directory are added to the version database as a new commit. So imagine we had those commits before, and now we change something else in the working directory. Apparently we remove the source folder completely, we make a new commit, and it appends this new working directory as a commit in the repository in the version database. All right, like I said, file status. So Git pays attention which files you changed. However, Git ignores files you didn't explicitly stage, which makes total sense. For example, if you have a project in the same folder than your source code, you, for example, also have backups of TensorFlow graphs or images or something, you don't want those in Git because Git is for code. So you pay attention that those files are untracked. So all files you don't want in your version history, for example, sensible data like passwords or something, you would just tell Git, won't tell Git to acknowledge the file, so it will be untracked. The next stage is unmodified files. So as soon as you edit a file to Git, first of all, it's staged. Let's go for stage now. As soon as you add a file to Git with the command git add, it will be staged, and staged files will be committed with the next commit. So you git add a few files, and then you enter git commit, and all the staged files will be committed with the next commit. Next up, then, there's unmodified. Once your staged files are committed, they become unmodified. Unmodified means that the file is registered in Git, but equal to the last commit. So after you committed, all files you did commit are obviously equal to the last commit because you just made the last commit equal to them. Then they're unmodified and Git will ignore them for now, but the file is registered. And the final layer is files that are registered for Git and were changed. Those are modified files. How to know which file is what? The command git status will tell you which file is what. Okay, but first of all, So those are the commands which change the file status of files. So imagine you just created a new project, you just initialized your Git repository, and then you add a file. So first of all files are untracked, and then you add a file. We'll change the flag of the file to stage. So Git knows as soon as you hit the command git commit, it will add the file to your version database. Okay, so if we then commit now, the next command is we git commit, all staged files are committed and are thus unmodified because they are the same as the last commit. Okay, if you then edit unmodified files, so just opening some editor and editing them, they become modified. And if they are modified, you would have to git add them again such that they become staged for the next commit, for them to be in the version database of the next commit. If you want to commit all modified files, there's a command for that too, and that's git commit minus a, which will add all tracked files and commit them right away. So if you changed files and don't want to explicitly add every single file you staged, you can just run git commit minus a, and all staged files, all tracked files will be committed. Okay, that makes sense so far. Good. Like I said, we have those four statuses, and the command git status will tell you which files are staged, tracked, and so on. So imagine we had this, we are somehow in our project, we run the command git status, will tell us branch and tell us that the branch is up to date with the GitHub correspondence, that doesn't matter for you now, but it will tell us changes to be committed, those two files. So those two files here are staged. Changes not staged for commit, but git knows of them, is this one. So this one is also, it says it's modified, so this one has it's modified. And then there's also an untracked file here, which is this. So git will tell you about that. So if you now would run the command git commit, it would put commit those two files to the version database. If you would run the command git commit minus a, it would add those three files. Okay, git status is a command you basically, so when I'm using git, every other command literally is git status. So I do git status, I add some files, I do git status, I add some files, I commit, I do git status to check if the files were actually committed. And git status is just a really important command to know what's going on, to know what git will do. Okay, so what's your workflow in git, obviously? Well, you have a project with some files. Imagine this being your initial commit, and then you change those files, so those are just changed and not yet added to git. In the next step, you would stage them by running git add kernel onion, git add kln onion, and git add lln test. And then you commit with a command git commit, and then you would have this structure. So this would be a second commit in which we changed and added those three files. Git doesn't know yet that this file was changed because we didn't edit. We do that now. We stage that file by saying git add, and then we commit again, and now all four files are changed in comparison to the first commit. In comparison to that commit, one new file changed. Right? Git. Okay. Git is something else than GitHub, even though the line is kind of blurry. So Git is a version control system which is supposed to run local on your computer, GitHub is a website, which is basically simply a server to store your projects on, with also a nice UI web interface to access and collaborate with others. So Git works perfectly fine without GitHub, but if you want to publish your code, for example, you will use GitHub. Also the website GitHub, so this is Git's logo, this is GitHub, the GitHub logo. So GitHub also adds many additional features. Anybody who uses Git will probably know that you can make pull requests with code review, you have issues, you have wikis and so on. So the GitHub website is really useful. But like I said, it's only external storage and a nice UI, and Git works perfectly fine locally without GitHub. However, GitHub is really useful if you want to work on the same file on multiple computers. Because then you both have your Git on your personal computer and you both push, so uploading to GitHub is called push, you both push to the same repository, and the version control system makes sure that you're working on the same version and that your changes to code files well, go along and don't have any merge conflicts. However, you need to manually synchronize your local directory with GitHub. So what you committed in Git is not yet on GitHub. You need to push to GitHub at first. I will do a demo in 1 minute to show you that. Okay, so but first of all, how would distributed version control system work? Well, imagine this here is the server, the GitHub server, and somebody from outside created this initial commit. All right, so this is the commit C1. Then you pulled the changes from GitHub, you make some changes, you make one commit and another commit, and then in the same time, this computer C also pulled add commit one, and made another commit. This is obviously a completely different one than yours. And at the same time, somebody completely else made this commit C4 and commit C6 somewhere. Now, on the GitHub server, you would have version C6. On Susie's computer, you would have the version C5, and yours, you would have the version C3. So if you push, it will tell you, somebody else did something here, you did something here. Please pull and merge first. Then you have to pull the local, the remote changes to yourself, change and resolve merge conflicts, if there are any, and merge those two commits, and then you can push again, and then there would be a C7, which would be a merge of C6 and C3. So it makes sure that no changes go undetected and are deleted afterwards, because you always have to pull all the remote changes before you change something locally. However, that only if it's if you use GitHub. If you use version control system, like only Git on your computer, that won't matter for you. All right, is that clear so far? Good, then I will do a demo. Yeah. Okay, oops. I hope, that's not too. Can you read that now? I mean, the blue folder names won't occur again, so the font will be gray. I think that's fine. Okay, so first up, let me make a folder. So this is just the console. The command line. Okay, but now we're in some folder. It's an empty folder. Okay, let's make a to-do list here. Just make a new file, to-do.txt. Just add a to-do. So this is just the VI editor, right? Who had info A? You had the VI editor, right? No? Okay, that doesn't matter. It's just a random editor. You enter the command VI something to open it, and then dot WQ to change and quit. Doesn't matter for you. However, okay, what do we do? Okay, we now have a file todo.txt here. So let's make a Git repository out of that. How do we do that? The command is git init. So git init now made a new folder here, as you can see with the ls-a command, .git. So this is now our version database in this folder, .git. Okay, if I now run git status, like I said, it's literally every other command. I see, this todo.txt is untracked. So what do I do now? I use the command git add. So we see, git status, changes to be committed. We have a new file called todo.txt. Yay. Okay, so imagine I want to have a backup of that because it's hard to recreate. Oh, yes. Sorry? Yes. Yes. Yes, for this folder. If I go, so I can now git status in this folder, and if I change to the folder above that, if I say git status here now, it says, map, there's no git repository. So git detects if something is a git repository by seeing if there's a folder called .git in there.
Pardon?
Yes, so you use Git for projects, and this assumes you have the project, you have the projects in the same folder. The project in the same folder. Okay, so I added the file, now I need to commit. Oops. The minus m parameter means message, because like I said, if I commit, I always need to provide a message. And my message here is added first to do. Okay, so now if I run git status, will tell me, aha, nothing to commit, working to recreate. Okay, so now this file is in Git, and Git knows of this file, and Git will be able to restore the version of my project, of my to-do list, from now on forever as this version. So, how do I know what I committed? If I run the command git log, it will tell you what you committed so far. So like I said, it always stores hash, author and date, and message. So it tells me now this is the hash. It's just something really long, but the first 7 signs of that will always be enough. It says who committed because of my git username, and when I committed, and what I said to that. So, okay. So now if I change my to-do list, I just open the editor and say, and that's something, saving and closing. If I now git status, it will tell me I modified the to-do.txt file. Okay, if I now git commit, there are no changes added. Why not? Because I either need to add the to-do.txt file manually again, or I just run the command git commit minus a. And now, oh damn, I want to change the commit message. Make useful commit messages, not this way. But yeah, now I now added a new to-do. As you can see in git log, there's a new commit now to this repository. Okay, let's assume I went shopping now and I bought those 2 things. Now I can use, well, first of all, git status, aha, this file changed. Now I can use the command git diff to tell me the difference between the new version of the files as they are in my working directory and the last commit. So what git diff tells me is the difference between this last commit here and the files in my working directory. And now it tells me I deleted the lines by apples and by milk. Okay, to restore the file, because maybe I just did something wrong, maybe I just did not go shopping, I can just check out the file again. And if I now look at it, ta-da, we're back. I could also check out an earlier version of the repository by using git checkout and then the previous commit hash if I want to restore something at a prior point. There's many more commands to git. But I think that will suffice for now. I will explain the ones to pull from the repository in a second anyway, when I go to your homework, but that should be it for general git. Yes, so that's just if you want to look at those slides at home where you don't have this presentation, you can use those 2 to know of some git commands. Okay. Final remarks on Git. Yeah, Git is made for source code. I didn't notice an upper limit to file sizes for Git yet, so you can in theory just push gigabytes of files to Git. However, it's just not useful for that. It's not made for that. It's no Dropbox. So you want to add only text-based files to Git or diffable files. So like I said, I use the command git diff, and imagine it would be a non-text-based file, a Word document or an image or something, and it would try to tell me on the terminal the difference between those files. It just wouldn't make any sense. So Git can diff text-based files, but for everything else, it just doesn't make too much sense. So it's for source code, it's for not much else. And to not add unnecessary files, because there's this very useful command, git add dot, sorry if I use the command. So if I add a new file here, it's now here, and I've used the command git add dot. Every single file in my folder will be added. As you can see here now, I didn't explicitly specify it. But if you have files in your folder that are non-source code files, you don't want to add them too, because like I said, git's not made for that. Add a git ignore file to your repository and write file name masts there, which you want to completely ignore, and git behaves as if it wouldn't see them then. Next up, all modern editors I know of come with git integration. That is really useful. So for example, PyCharm and Atom show you which files you changed and which file you didn't. It's really useful. However, we advise not to use those at first until you're really familiar with Git. The Git integration of those editors is also just a GUI for the normal Git commands, which we just entered here. And learning how those commands really work by heart before using the GUI for those is really useful and really recommended. If you're not familiar with Git, there's this website on Git, there's this page on GitHub, try.github.io. It's really useful for learning Git. And for deeper looks, check this link. Okay, oh yeah, speaking of IDEs, which IDE do you want to use? We recommend Atom. It's a hackable editor for the 21st century, that's what they call themselves. It's really useful for Python because there's this package Hydrogen, and with Hydrogen you can just select your code, control enter, and then you can just run your Python code, which makes total sense. Also, Atom is free and open source. It has code completion, syntax highlighting, everything you need in an IDE, and it's really useful. However, I would recommend it rather for smaller projects containing only a few files, and for bigger projects, there's PyCharm. PyCharm is too big for small projects, I'd say. So it has a bunch of capabilities, but it's also it takes more resources and so on. And PyCharm is a commercial one, and it's closed source. However, it has a community edition, which is free. And as students, if we apply with our @us email account, we can also get the professional version for free. And like I said, it has many components. It has a graphical debugger, code analysis features, of course, Git integration, many features, some of which you will detect just in 10 years, some eventually, I guess. But like I said, it's useful for bigger projects, not really recommended for the homework of this course because you will mostly be working on a few files. Okay, then there's VI, which you just saw. It's integrated into Unix systems and it runs literally inside the terminal. It's hard to master and supposedly much faster once you did master it. I guess I didn't master it yet because I hate VI and I don't use it. So if you want, I guess there are some people who will use it, but yeah. Okay, and then JuPyter Notebook. We showed you already how a JuPyter Notebook file looks like. You have formatted strings in there, and code, and results and plots of your code. So JuPyter Notebook doesn't only contain code, but also that. And it's really cool because it makes pretty notebooks that can be exported to HTML or PDF, which is really useful, for example, for us here, because we want to give you a PDF of what we did. So we will give you probably PDFs of JuPyter Notebooks. You can also export to a Python script. However, for this class, please don't use it because JuPyter Notebook are not as diffable as pure text files, because if you change something, it changes formatting and so it still changes the text file, which you don't want. And they can't be handled by PyTest, which is what we use to test your homework. And also, please save yourself the pain and don't code in some notepad because you want syntax highlighting for completion. I don't know how you would code without it. Okay. So let's come to the homework. How does the homework work here? Homework is distributed via GitHub Classroom. In other words, you do need a GitHub account to submit the homework, otherwise you just won't be able to get or submit the homework. And if there are mistakes in the homework, we will announce that and update the repositories. Andre just mentioned something which is actually wrong in the homework. So regularly pull, because maybe we need to change something. And I heard that Patrick and Brian last year did it really often. It's really useful, just do that. Okay, and this is, for example, the repository, the GitHub repository, as it looks on GitHub, of the first homework. And there are a few files. I'm just going to explain in a second what those files are. So like I said, I explained what a git ignore is. It makes sure you and we don't commit unnecessary stuff by accident. And then there's the .travis.yaml. It's necessary because the script we use to correct your homework will rely on that. There's the README, which contains the task description. So we won't give you the task description as a PDF on StudIP. We will just point you to the link of the GitHub Classroom, where you will find the repository, where we will find the README.md. And on GitHub, the README is prettily formatted. So this is the content of this README here, the first lines. Okay, then there's, in this case, a hello world.py, which contains the bare bone structure of the task itself. Requirements.txt, the list of packages you will need in your environment for this task, which is empty as of now, but I need to add PyTest, because of course you need PyTest. And then some testing files. So all files, test underscore, are used for PyTest. Don't change it, we use those, and you use those to see if your program works as intended. Please don't change them. Okay, PyTest. PyTest is a testing library included with Python. And what PyTest does, so if you run Python PyTest from the terminal or from the Windows command line, if you use Windows, and what it simply does, it grabs all test underscore functions and all files named test underscore something, execute them and check for errors. And we'll do them by using assertions. So in this test underscore hello, no, add something else. So in the test underscore primes from the second exercise, there's, for example, the line assert prime dot find prime 1 equals 2. You are supposed to write the method find prime, and we just look if your code returns what we want you to return. So in this case, imagine we just, I wrote the find prime method, but I did something wrong. Then it will tell me, and we'll look at the entire file test underscore prime. First of all, assign it asserts prime dot find prime equals 2, find prime 1 equals 2, which is the case, so my program worked here. However, as the 8th prime, my program returned 11, because find.find prime parameter 8 returns 7 here. You see this function here is find.find prime. We went this with the parameter 8, it returned 11. Now we're saying 11 equals 13, map, that doesn't work. So PyTest said there's something wrong in your program. If you see that, you're not done yet. If PyTest says something red, you can backtrack where your error was, which is really useful. And then you can go back to fix that and run PyTest again and see if it works now, fix something else, run PyTest again. So this is the workflow of this of so-called test-driven development. In test-driven development, you first write a failing test, so you work a test for what you wanted to create. You make the test pass by changing your code, and you refactor, adding new features, you make a new failing test, you make sure the test pass by changing your code, and so on and so on. So this cycle here is how you will work on your projects. And with the difference that those failing tests are provided by us. So if you get the homework, you can just run PyTest, you see all the test is failing, why is it failing, you can do something, make the test pass, then it will fail in a later line, you can do something new, make the test pass, and so on, until in the end, it looks like this. Now it says two functions passed and something, and as soon as you get this result, you're sure your test passes, you can commit your stuff, you can push your stuff to GitHub, and you will get the pass for this homework. Okay, once this is the result of a PyTest, the homework will pass. Okay, now for the last 15 minutes, I will go through that and explain how to do that. Okay, I will, for that, not like that. I don't have a signal anymore. Why do you still have a signal? It's gerade wieder da, ne?
Okay. Ja.
Zu einem neuen Fenster. Okay. So this is what you will see if you hit the link. I will just use not my repository because I'm admin of this thingy. Okay, so imagine you are an Eisner and whoop. You want to join. First of all, you need to join the WASTA. A WASTA is what matches your GitHub accounts to your etc logins. Because, of course, your GitHub accounts don't need to contain your name, so you need to assign yourself here to your etc login. So you logged in with a GitHub account, now you need to say who you are. In this case, it's Nina. Nein, kann man nicht. I tried it. I don't know why. Weiß nicht. Okay, then you hit right. Oh, because I did it locally. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, I just selected Nina and I selected accept this exercise. Okay, so now it tells me my assignment has been created. So what this does is it clones. So we have this one repository where we publish the homework. And you clone this repository to a private repository by accepting the assignment. Now after I click that, I just accept the assignment. And now, shit, that's the wrong folder. That was not correct. There it is. Okay, I need to do that again. I don't know if I can still add Nina here. We'll see. Who's aus? I can take off this one. No, I deleted him, I think. Okay, so assuming I'm aus now, I'm accepting this assignment as aus. The previous thing didn't work because I did it on my GitHub account, and as I'm admin, I already have the repository, obviously. Now I click here. And it will clone the repository for me. Now I'm in Eisner. That doesn't make any sense at all. Never mind that. Okay, so now this is all the files which you saw already. And now I can select clone and copy the link to clone the repository and then open up a console, a terminal. I always have caps lock. So I make a new directory homework, and I use the command, you haven't heard that one before, git clone, and then the URL. Oh yeah, sorry. I use the command git clone. Weird, okay. Should be not myself, but Nina here, but. Okay, and now we see, if we look at the folder, there's now a new folder called homework one in Eisner. And there's all the files from the repository in there. So what you want to do at first, because we didn't add so in the requirements.txt, first you need to pip install PyTest. Oh yeah. oops. What do we have my to-do here? All right. Good, we see I'm in the homework folder now, blah, blah. Now at first, as we said, we're using virtual environments. So the first thing I do, of course, I activate the Conda environment here by oh yeah, oops, of course, cannot create. So I use this command to create a new virtual environment with Conda. This won't happen on your computer, this only happens on mine, but I can source change Conda. Why do I need to do that? Because I didn't have Conda in my path. So now I do, this is a script that would, it doesn't matter for you, you will just be able to run the command Conda create. Because you will add Conda to your path, or if you don't, you will use the Anaconda prompt where all Conda commands are activated. We explain how to use the Anaconda prompt and how to install Conda and git the correct way. It's explained on the homework sheet, as you see here. Okay, so now I can run the command Conda create this, and now it will create a new environment and install a bunch of necessary libraries into it. Now, tada, it's done. Now we can just source activate scientific. And now I'm in this Conda environment, which the terminal tells me by saying so, by having this scientific here. And now I see, so pip freeze shows you your currently installed libraries. And believe me, I have a bunch of libraries on my actual Python. And now I only have this one, which was in the requirements.txt. As the PyTest was, unfortunately, we will change that in a second, was not in the repository yet, we need to pip install PyTest manually here. So if you download it, if you clone the repository already, you need to pip install PyTest. Otherwise, if you do it in 5 minutes, so after the lecture, we will add PyTest to the requirements.txt. So if you create, so this means conda create an environment, minus n is the name, scientific is the name of our environment. The Python version we want to have is 3.6, and we want to create it with all the libraries in the file requirements.txt. So in the file requirements.txt, we write what libraries you need, and conda will automatically install it if you run this command. Okay, if I now do pip freeze again, it tells me I also have PyTest. And the other ones were necessary for PyTest. So when installing PyTest, it installed them with it. Yes?
Do we have to install more packages when we progress in the course? Or
yes, because in later on you need NumPy, you need pandas and so on. We will have another requirements.txt. So the requirements.txt file will always contain all the libraries you need for this very homework. So if you use the command for conda to add them to your environment, which I just did with the minus minus file requirements.txt, it will automatically install them. So if you install it like this, you can be sure it installed everything you need. If you activated, created a conda environment like this. Okay, so now that I have PyTest, so this is actually your first homework, so if, now that I have PyTest, I can run PyTest, and it tells me, oh, there's a function which is not implemented. So if you got here, you're almost 99.9% there, because the actual function is just, as you can see in the task description, just to add the function to say hello. The PyTest will guide you on how you have to write that. So you can look in the homework here. I will just do that here, and not seen by you. So I just added the file that it works. So this is literally how long a homework will take. And if I now run PyTest again, it will tell me, yay, everything's all right. That's good, because then I can git push. Oh, no, wait. Oh, git status tells me I modified, but I didn't edit. So I just git commit minus a minus m solved it.
Haven't you edited? Don't you have to edit first?
I had the command git commit minus a. And because you pulled the repository, and you pulled the Git folder with it. And in the Git folder, it knew already that it was added. But yeah, to be explicit, I should have Git edited before. But as we see now, if we run Git status again, it's committed. And now that I committed it, I need to Git push to origin and my branch master. So there's also branching in Git. You don't need to know that for now. We maybe explain that later. Just if you use the command git push, this is where you push. And the second command is basically always master. So git push origin master. OK, now it told us that it uploaded it to GitHub. And if I now go to GitHub again and look here, it says now 3 commits. And my commit solved that is on GitHub. And if I look here, that was too early. Now your PyTest passed and you uploaded it, and as soon as you see your commit here, it will pass our test too. So we wrote a script that automatically fetches the newest commits to GitHub and uses PyTest of them and sees if PyTest passes or fails. It starts like 15 minutes maximally after your first commit. So if you take more, if I would have taken 15 minutes or more for this exercise, there would already be a green mark next to here. Yeah, I won't do that now. If you see, so you go to commits then and you see the green mark right there. And if you see the green mark next to your task, you know your homework is done, you will pass the test, and you will hopefully get an email automatically telling you, yeah, you passed. If you should get wrong emails, please don't be mad at us at automatic saving scripts and scripts. And there may be something wrong in them. So please don't be mad at us if the script tells your email tells you cheated. That may be by coincidence, and we can check that manually, of course, then. But we hope this automatic checking will work fine. Oh yeah, Atom. I wanted to show you Atom. Oh yeah, sorry. No, unfortunately not, but we will need to manage that. Unfortunately not, I tried that. That's really unfortunate. Okay.
Yes?
Yes?
The bonus question or homework counts towards the line.
Yes.
It would be 2 out of 5 in line just in this
minute. Yes.
Okay, do we get bonus questions or bonus homeworks every
week? No. The question was, do the bonus questions point like normal homework? Yes, they do. There are two. There's one normal exercise, which is the one I just showed you, and one bonus exercise this week. So if you have those two, you already have 2 out of 9, but there won't be one every week. So don't rely on that. It will be really sparse. No. We're not sure on that, how many bonus tasks there will be. Sorry. But the first ones will be the simplest one, I guess, anyway, so we'll do the first ones. Yes?
One virtual environment for our class for the semester at the moment, right?
Yes, it is.
So we don't need any specific different kind of programming types?
No. If it should clash, if there should be something which requires another version of another library, we will say so in the task. So the first exercise sheet tells you how to install the environment, how to activate the environment, basically everything I did here, the first will show you, and from then on, if something changes, we will announce that. Marie?
When is the deadline for the homework each week?
Oh, yeah. The deadline for the next homework is next week at 2. So the deadline is when this class starts. And then after this class, took place, we will send the email telling you if you passed or failed. Maybe during, but I'm not sure if I can rely on the script, so. Anna.
If 2 people commit the exact same code, like if 2 people work together, is it fine?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, at least in the first exercise, of course, you will commit the exact same code. But yeah, that's fine. You can work together, you just need to commit it. But again, you want to learn something here, so please don't do that. The repositories are private if you create them. So you're encouraged to write your own stuff. Blah, blah, blah. Oh yeah, you need to sign to GitHub. Use your OS mail to get unlimited free repositories from GitHub. Oh yeah, if your set login is not listed in the roster, I just added the last ones right before the lecture. But if you don't find your set login in the roster, the very first thing where I selected an Eisner, why does an email, or if it's spelled incorrectly, because we need to manually copy that from StartIP to GitHub Classroom. Yeah, then sometimes it will tell you when you clone this, preparing your repository, there's no need to keep this window open with email, you want the important done. That's a really stupid thing because it's done in 5 seconds. So just hit F5 and it's done. There's no email anyway. good, this is how it looks. I just showed you all of that. This is how you clone, those are the commands you need. If you forgot the domain of your repository, you can use the command git config get remote.origin.url if you forgot the domain. And oh yeah, this is how it would have looked like if I waited 15 minutes. So if you see this green mark right next to your last commit, you can be sure for sure that you passed our test, because that is our test. Maybe it's done now. Nope, 6 minutes, that's not 15. Okay. Yeah, the first check will perform 5 to 15 minutes after accepting the exercise. From then on, everyone will commit to be accepted. Yeah, first deadline next Tuesday at 2. Clone the repository at least 15 minutes before the deadline passes, because otherwise the green mark won't occur, as you saw here. Yes, you get the test goods. Don't check that. There's a cheat. Don't change them. There's a cheat detection, which I already told the test people I used it for, that they cheated. And yeah, you get an email telling you if you passed or failed.
So is it Tuesday or Monday?
Today's Monday. It's Tuesday. It's Monday. I'm sorry. Sorry, it's next Monday at 2. All right, that's it. Wait, I wanted to show you Atom. Okay, so what you do in Atom, yeah? You can select stuff. Oh yeah, I need to file it. So if I now have a Python file, you can just select the cells and hit Control Enter and executes Python code, which is really nice. Why did I do that? Okay, I'm sorry, that was stupid. But yeah, thank you for your attention.